Rochester's News Center, your source for news, traffic watch, AccuWeather, and local talk. 1017 FM, 1150 AM WDEL.
All right, 1025 here on Delaware. Welcome. You know, the president committing to the goal of ending HIV transmission within a decade and a year by 2030. So how realistic is that, and how would it be achieved? Realistically, let's bring in live from Valhalla, New York, Dr. Keosha Bond, medical school professor, specializing in AIDS, HIV research, and epidemiology, visiting faculty fellow, Yale University School of Public Health. And Dr., thanks so much for joining us. Welcome. When you hear this, are you encouraged? Are you exhilarated? This sounds like, well, countdown to a space program. Or no, your eyes roll. You think it's more political talk and nothing really meaningful will happen. What do you think?
Well, in all honesty, we, especially individuals who work in the field, we don't feel that it's impossible, but we also understand that it's going to take a lot more work than just writing these words in a plan to actually get to these goals. You know, we're going to have to take our efforts to the next level to reduce new infection, and that means we're going to have to actually address the barriers that fuel the epidemic in these communities that they're planning to address.
If you were asked by President Trump or somebody in his administration, Doctor, write up for us what you would do if you were given this kind of federal allocation of money and resources, what would you say or write?
One of the things I think that's important is that we have an approach of continuum of care when it comes to HIV, and that's going to require the efforts of the local, state, and federal levels and addressing the barriers that we have in those communities, which is poverty, access to health care, lack of education and outreach in these areas, addressing the discrimination that patients may, people who live in those communities may deal with. So and also addressing some of the issues related to decriminalizing syringe exchange programs. So this is not just going to be a one-size-fits-all approach to this. This is going to take multiple approaches to actually addressing the issue. And the plan also, I think one of the most important things is addressing some of the structural barriers, the main one being access to health care, access and availability. So you're looking at some of these communities that they may have they access to care, meaning that they have insurance or they have a certain level of insurance, but then is this these resources and these services, are they available in the communities that they're at, especially in these rural communities? Do they have to travel outside of the community just to get treatment, just to get an HIV test, just to get, you know, preventative care of that nature? So these are the things that need to be addressed, I guess, with the policymakers, and that how are we providing resources to the individuals in the community.
Well, would you say the greater problem is access to health care or access to proper health care, or still in some segments a lifestyle of drug use or sexual proclivity that makes this transmission continue?
I think we've learned from the research that HIV and the reason why it is an epidemic and the reason why it has thrived in some areas is not just based off of the individual's behavior. I think we have found countless research that supports that it is the structural barriers that have actually fueled it in some communities versus others. And if you can look at many of the communities and the counties that are placed on the list as being the target communities, they are also dealing with lack of health care within those communities. They are dealing with high levels of poverty and other and residential segregation. So to kind of place it on the fact that it's, you know, how it's transmitted, meaning these biological factors, is not the only thing that's happening.
Only a few seconds, Doctor. Maybe it's an apples and oranges question, but which do you think is more daunting now, dealing with opioids or dealing with HIV?
I don't think you can
quantify it.
Address one with one
without
the other.
The other
right now.
I kind of figured.
Because we know that the epidemic with opioids is one that can actually fuel the HIV epidemic.
Yeah, they work hand in hand. Got to go. Dr. Keosha Bond, New York Medical College, thanks for joining us here for a few minutes on Delaware.
Live from Delaware's News Center.